It is fiercely storming outside here. Just howling winds and cold. I don't know how long I'll be able to actually stand up to this. It's the day after I... What did I do? deactivated my Facebook account. And I said, what's going to happen? I don't know. So, what are my dreams going to be like? Well, they were extraordinary. I don't even know if I can even explain what the significance. It was so great. I may wait a little while to see how it unfolds, but it already started unfolding today. What an amazing day. So, we can start with saying this, that there's so many different great flipping the script moments happened today. It's hard to recount them all. But the latest one was that I feel so embarrassed for everyone in the world in terms of the way they're acting. It's so embarrassing. The immaturity of those spirits that are expressing in this world right now. And I don't want to see it. I don't want to see, like, if you have a good friend and they're acting like a complete idiot, making fools of themselves in such a bad way that, you know, eventually they'll come out of it and they'll say, wow, I was such an idiot. I hope nobody saw me. And they're going to ask you, did you see me? You didn't see me, did you? And if you say yes, they're going to say, I don't really want anything to do with you. I mean, you saw me at my worst. I didn't want you to see me at my worst. I mean, I'm so embarrassed about it all. Sometimes the best thing you can do for a friend is don't pay attention to them. Don't pay attention to them. So everyone are my dear, you know, friends in spirit here, but they're behaving very badly and just, you know, crazy. The world is really nuts right now, more than I can even begin to even... It's pathetic. It's beyond pathetic. So why should I, or why should any of us, pay attention to this? The most compassionate thing we can do is just don't pay attention at all. That's love. That's compassion right there. Don't, when someone's at their worst, don't pay attention to what they're doing. Because later they'll say, you didn't see me, did you? And I say, no, I didn't pay attention. I say, oh, thank God, thank you so much. You know that you were wise enough to realize I was at my worst, and you didn't pay any attention to that. That'll be gratefully helpful to them. This is how I see it. Because they'll be shocked later on about how they'll want to move on, and they'll be shocked by it, want to move on, and they'll say, is there anybody that didn't pay any attention to me when I was, you know, so stupid? And I want to be able to say, yeah, I didn't pay any attention. I knew it was stupid, but why should I, you know, hold you to that? And it'll help you move on if I just say I didn't pay any attention to it, so let's move on. I don't have any attachment to it at all. It's emergency vehicles. It is storming. It's unusual for April for right now. This storm, supposed to be a bunch of... Wow. Holy cow. It's just severe gusts. Now, I did another thing today that I haven't done in ages. I refuse to look at the weather report because they keep sneaking a bunch of really terrible stuff on there. I mean, the world is in a deplorable condition mentally. Okay, mentally, almost virtually everyone on this planet is in a deplorable mental condition right now. So again, why pay attention to it? It's better just to not pay any attention to it at all. So I'm praying that I'm able to get in a situation more and more where I don't pay attention. I didn't pay attention to the weather report. Again, they slip a lot of junk on there, a lot. And I said, it's not worth it. I can stick my head out the window. What's it doing? Oh, it's raining and it's windy. Okay, great. I'll stick my head out the window in the morning and see how it is in the morning. And if it's raining, it's raining. I'll put on a raincoat. Wow, I have to hold this computer now. I mean, that wind is ferocious. But that's okay. You don't need to look at the weather. That starts pulling you in to stuff. And I noticed that how you get pulled in. So I'm trying to pull back from the internet, trying to pull back from the world. We have some friends of ours who are gallivanting all over the place right now. And they're notifying us from all these different places. We're here now. We're going here. Going here. And I said, you know what? The road is still a road. It's just a road. No matter what road you're on, it's just a road. Okay, it's the same road here, it's the same road anywhere, and you got to drive your car with the, you know, caution. It's the same way anywhere. Driving is just driving. Roads are just roads, actually. And dirt where you are is exactly the same as the dirt where I am, right? It's just dirt. It's dirt. And the air is the air. And you still get hungry, and you still have to eat, and you still get tired, and you still have to sleep. And houses are just houses. Right? And trees are just trees, and plants are just plants. I mean, where is the romance really in this world? It's ridiculous. Rocks are rocks. The sunshine is the sunshine. But that's the road, on the road, the romance of the road. I don't feel it like I used to, really. It's asphalt is asphalt. You're driving along a patch of asphalt. Doesn't matter where you are in the world, it's still just a road. I mean, everything is basically the same all over the world, isn't it? Still got to chew your food, go to the bathroom, smells just as bad, you know, whether you're in your palace or somewhere else, right? I mean, all the struggles, all the troubles are basically all the same, no matter where you go. So you're not going to escape that by traveling. So today I had this tremendous practicing that was very profound, and he hit so hard. So I could say, we can look at this possibly. And I coined a new phrase called mentally existent. I'm not mentally existent. Mental existence. I don't like the word conditioned existence. It's okay, it's good, but mental existence is a better term to use. And we've fallen into the delusion of mental existence. Mentally existing. Mental existence. And we're actually so close. Truth is so close to us. It's so close to us. It's so close that we certainly cannot perceive it. And it's so close, nothing can be said about it. It's that close. There's no way to analyze how close we are to truth. And we're as close to this truth right this instant, right now, as we ever will be. Right now, we're so close, there's nothing to even analyze. It's so close. There's not even a subject for the closest to be subject to. That's how close we are to truth. And just practicing on that was so profound. We're so close that it arrives without us even being able to notice it. That's how close we are. And we're always that close to the truth. We're that close right this instant. That's how close we are. So it's so close that there's nothing there to analyze. That's how close it is. Beyond analysis, beyond perception, that's how close we are. And it's just the trick of we thought we're mentally existent. Okay, and it's just, all we have to do is just realize we're not mentally existent. There's no mental existence. There's no mental existence. Cold out here. Wow. Bet you the mountains are going to get some more snow out of this for sure. Well. And maybe we just got used to the warm weather and the contrast is getting us. To be lured into mental existence is the fall. But how far do we fall? The fall is so short, there's no way to even analyze how short it is. That's how short it is. There's no way to measure it. There's no way to measure how short the fall was. You could say there was a fall, but again, it's such a short fall. It's not. We can't even perceive it. Can't even be measured. So how far do we have to go to pick ourselves up? It's such a short distance that again, it can be no subject object to even experience. It's such a short, so short. So that's how close we are right now. So everything I say is by way of practice to try and encourage you to actually practice with this. It's beyond theory. Our fall into metal, into believing in that the mind can exist, mental existence, is there's nothing you could say about it. We're so close to realizing there's no such thing as mental existence. So there's the mental existence has no extension to it at all. Okay, so there's nothing to measure there. That's how close we are. Immeasurably close. Imperceptibly, immeasurably close. And I'm freezing out here. I wore a sweater, but it's... Man. I could always get something else, but... I'll tough it out for a little while longer. Maybe make this one a short one. A short one, yeah. Had some remarkable meetings today. Remarkable meetings. I don't even understand exactly. One of them I understand. The other one I didn't quite understand exactly. But the first one was... I led to the second one. You might say that. And I had someone kind of talk to me and prophesize my future. They didn't know, but the words they were saying was speaking directly to me. And they were saying, you know, telling me how it's going to go. I said, wow, it's going to go really well. Really, really well. And the first thing may be just to not pay any attention to the downfall of everyone. That's embarrassing to them. It's too embarrassing. That, you know, that when you do really embarrass yourself, you just hope nobody saw you do it. That's all. Right? That's what you're praying for, isn't it? When you do something really stupid, you look around and say, I hope nobody saw me. And when you find out nobody saw you, you're so relieved. And you forgive yourself. Say, oh, wow, I'm not going to do that again. But if someone saw me, then you're really going to start obsessing about it. So we'll just not watch the downfall of this world. Okay? Just don't watch the downfall of this world. So if later on someone says, oh, what a horrible downfall. I say, what? I don't know anything about it, really. Just vague rumors or some downfall, but I didn't pay any attention. I know whatever happened, you'll get back on your feet real soon, real easy. It's not a problem. And then they'll be relaxed. Oh, great, great, great. I'm not so embarrassed. It's hard to relate. If you embarrass yourself in front of someone, it's hard to relate to them, isn't it? It really is. And the whole world's just embarrassing themselves to an unbelievable extent right now. Sometimes I'm so embarrassed for people. I don't pay attention to them. And you know, there's some people, I'm not going to mention their names because that would mortify them maybe, but you know, some very famous, popular people and the hosts of this and that I cannot watch. I'm so embarrassed for them. I cannot watch. And so I'm doing them a great favor because the later on they'll say, you didn't watch me, did you? I said, no, I paid no attention to you. You're kind of, I could tell you're really out of it. So I'm not going to pay any attention. And just wait until you come out of it. And then, oh, great. Great, great, great. And so that's love. That's love right there, you see? Don't give people a chance to embarrass themselves in front of you. Because they can. They can. They don't try to take a high line and say, there's nothing anyone can do to be embarrassing. Oh, of course there is. Of course there is. The entire world is just... The fourth dimensionals are just nuts. You know, they're so out of it. Spiritually out of it. So spiritually out of it. I talked to a man today, a Christian. And I was guided to him. The Holy Spirit guided me. I actually went over to him and asked him, how was God treating you? How is God treating you? And he lit up and started talking. We had a long, long talk, and I mostly listened. And he gave this testimony and talk. It was so extraordinary. Really, Christians, these type of Christians are as good as it gets in the world, actually. Part of the problem of Facebook is there's a lot of problems. There's nothing but a problem there, actually. But I tried to speak of Jesus, etc. Nothing. On social media, Jesus is like dead. In terms of, if you want any credibility, you can't even talk about Jesus. And people are embarrassed. Say, oh, I'm embarrassed for you or something. What? So I'm not going to hit my head against that wall. I said, Jesus, they're treating you like junk here. I this is embarrassing. They're embarrassing themselves. I don't want to watch it I don't want to pay attention anymore. And so talking to this Christian, just a very lowly, humble man, and telling him, he told me a little bit about his life, but he was lit up like he was glowing, like the Holy Spirit. I mean, he's just glowing. He was just glowing. He's a beautiful soul. I mean, he says hello and just, he's just grace-filled person. He's just grace-filled. He doesn't know a thing about non-duality, but I'm telling you, there's more love flowing out of him than any non-dualist I've come across, mostly, right? The garden variety. I mean, just the compassion and the love and the honesty and everything, that the Christian virtues that are coming out of him, is just, you know, just floors you. I told him, I'm just experiencing a spiritual earthquake here listening to you. I mean, it's just, I've got goosebumps. It's just the authenticity. It's just it's staggering. And he explained something to me I'd never understood before. Really, he helped me out in a lot of ways. And he told me his dad was dying of cancer. And his dad wouldn't ask help from God and couldn't get through to him. And finally someone got through to him and he actually did ask God for help, and he seemed to have a big change just before he died. And then he said, you know, that cancer is the best thing that ever happened to my dad. And I said, wow, I hear you, what you're saying. And he said, because that put him in such a situation where it really helped him realize that he needs God in his life. The cancer was just what he needed to really pressure him that way, and it worked. And he said, "This is," and I said, "You know, it's the way. Everything is God's grace. God uses illness like this and troubles to bring us to Him. Suffering to bring us to God. That's and he said that's so true. It's so true. And he calls that the blood of Christ. And he talked about it. And he said that." And he said he would pray over his children that the blood of Christ be given unto them. And what he meant was, is he prayed that in their life they would be given all the necessary afflictions and troubles and difficult circumstances to bring them into greater faith to God. And I've never heard of anything like that before in my life, but it was so profound. I just got goosebumps. So here's a Christian that understands what the blood of Christ really means. I've never understood what it meant. And it means suffering. It means, in Christianity, suffering is a virtue. I mean, Jesus is suffering on the cross. He's showing, look, suffering is the path of suffering. Suffering is a great virtue because it brings us, it puts the pressure on us. And of course, my whole life I've suffered horribly, and it's put the pressure on me. And I'm still suffering. And so that's the Christian path, you know. It's amazing that someone would actually pray for his children, that they have all the sufferings they needed to bring them to God. That's just one of the greatest things I've ever heard in my life. He wasn't praying, I hope you have a happy, rich, successful life and you be this. No, he was saying, I hope that you meet all the suffering that you need in this life to make your faith in God what it needs to be. I was just staggered by the whole thing. One of the most maybe the most spiritual conversation I've ever had in my life, and one of the more profound spiritual people I've ever met in my life. And to everybody else, he's just a nobody, you know, basically. He's just, but not to me. Yeah, that was profound. The whole conversation is profound, but that one thing there just was, you know, so showing you, I just showed me that the power of Christianity, you know, it has reached people through the ages. And it's just deplorable the way that it's being presented in the world and the newer generations in the world, and how, you know, this was the real deal. And I realized the depth of it and just how awesome it is. And they use techniques and practices. Theologically, they're not accurate, but practice transcends theology in a lot of ways, really. You need to do it works. They put pressure on themselves. They say, you know, if you don't accept God, you're going to go to hell forever, you know, for all eternity. Well, that's not true. It may feel like that all eternity, but you have to ultimately, God doesn't let you get off so easy. You have to repent. You'll have lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, lifetime until you finally repent and drop this notion of mental existence, being mentally existent. But it puts the pressure on, doesn't it, to say, you know, you're going to burn in hell forever. It's like sort of an enforced suffering upon the mind, saying, wow. So I understand that as a practice, you know, I finally understood that. I didn't argue with them or anything. I just understood that this is something they'd use to really focus their minds. Called the fear, put the fear of God in themselves. Say, holy cow, I just can't go on like this. And, you know, he talked a little bit about his life, how he hit the absolute bottom of the bottom, and how he was helped and brought to God. And now he's a jewel. You know, he's a jewel. A jewel of God's grace. What the redemptive power of faith in God is, you know, it's just wow. Sometimes we get a little too intellectual with all the non-dualism stuff. That's good too, as long as it's put into practice. The problem, what I see is there's not enough practice among moderns that, you know, they don't want to get into the guts of it. You know, this man was just all guts, you know. He's lived it, and he's not embarrassed about it or ashamed about it. It's just extraordinary, and he's not all intellectual about it. Or you know, it's just there's no wiggle room in him. He doesn't give himself any wiggle room. It's just, this is the gospel. This is the truth. I'm so glad I found God and Jesus, and you know, and my life is. I just feel so blessed, and the treasures of my life are not of this world. I'm not looking for treasure in this world at all. And he said, he said, this world is really nothing at all. It's empty. But he said, but the beauty is in searching for God and turning a life towards God. Then everything becomes beautiful because it's a means to find God. And I never heard it expressed that way before, but isn't that so true? That when everything is a means to find God or to relate to God, then that's the beauty of everything. But if you don't have God in your life, nothing is really that beautiful. You're seeking value to accumulate value, try to build up value, and it's not the same beauty. So he just felt everything is beautiful in his life, because everything is part of his relationship to God, and reminds him to pay attention to God. And what you know, talk about right priorities. Yeah, wow. So, you know, here I am, some, you know, very, very experienced in all sorts of different religions and certainly non-duality and all this stuff, but I'm humbly listening to this simple evangelical Christian, and I'm hearing more wisdom coming out of him than the other stuff, you know. And so I didn't try to say, you know, I'm really no better. No. I got goosebumps listening to it. I said, wow, this is really helpful hearing this. So you don't know, you know, where truth comes. Usually it's from the very humble. Very humble, and those who really seem to have nothing, but they're just so happy and hearing them, and we realize that's where it's really at. He has his priorities better than all those people on Facebook. I got to tell you, I mean, I stop Facebook and I meet a person who really has it spiritually, has it way more together than anyone on Facebook. And he's right here, you know. Just meet him in a parking lot right here. Then I was doing push-ups at a gas station. A man comes up to me and says, "Oh my gosh, that's great." He says, "I do those at the YMCA too. I saw what you're doing. That's so awesome." The first person ever has come up to me like that, really. And he kept saying, "Yeah, that's so good for you. I'm so glad to see you do that." And he kept emphasizing YMCA, YMCA. I don't know why. Why I'm Christian Association. Why something about Christian Association, Young Men's Christian Association. Then I ended up having a talk with a Christian later in the day. So, you know, it's like, wow, what's going on? And this man had like a Aloha shirt, Hawaiian shirt, saying me that. And he was like, he's looking at me so beautifully. He said, "God, that's so great that you're doing that." So God is like speaking to me. He said, you know, maybe you can find beautiful people, and it's not going to be on Facebook. Facebook kind of is like bizarre in a lot of ways. Overly bizarre. Kind of weird and creepy in lots of ways. I don't like turning anyone down if someone makes a friend request, but yeah, it's just like, this isn't working. This isn't working. The whole thing, this wasn't working at all. I couldn't get any love for Jesus at all on Facebook. Could not get any love for Jesus at all. Nothing. And yet here, disabled my account. The very next day, the dreams that I had were so extraordinary. Again, I can't even explain them to you right now. I want to wait and see what happens. That's how extraordinary they were. Maybe the greatest dreams ever last night. I don't want to try and talk them away. Talk it away, actually. That's how great the dreams are. And then I meet, you know, one of the greatest meetings of my life. Better than any meeting I've ever had on Facebook by far. Yeah, this was like the real deal. The real deal. I got witnessed to by the real deal. And I was complaining to Jesus and during the days bitterly. I said, you know, how come I don't meet anyone profound in my life? I never have. And then just an hour or so later after that complaint, I had this meeting and talk. Now my left arm, I was holding a bunch of stuff on my left hand while I was talking. I had to hold it to my, sort of, it was kind of heavy. And so the talk lasted so long, when I went to straighten my arm out, I could hardly straighten it out, and all my muscles had cramped, and they're still really painful. The left is really painful. Other people I know are having really severe pains on their left. I think the left is going to be a real, real pain soon in the world. And again, I don't want to see anyone embarrass themselves. It's really embarrassing. That's why I stopped following the world. And I'll really stop following the world totally at some point. The world itself is embarrassing. I mean, we don't ask the world to stop killing us. What we need to see, we're the ones who are trying to kill the world. We're killing the world. We're trying to get the world to be a killer. The world's not killing us. We're killing the world. So just stop killing the world. Okay, don't ask, "Hey world, you're killing me, or you're hurting me." No, we're hurting the world. We're trying to torture the world, but even beyond that, there is no world. In order to kill a world, you have to believe there's a world. So our desire to kill causes us to believe there's a world to kill. Consider that. The same thing, desire to kill the body makes us believe there's such a thing as a body. You can't kill freedom. There's nothing there to kill. So you have to believe that there's a world. I mean, time, space, process, and form, to kill anything. To believe you can kill anything. And killing is our way of trying to fixate the mind. So we're trying to kill the world. The world's not trying to kill us. There's not even an existent world, a mentally existent world at all. There's nothing mentally existent. There's nothing mentally existent. Mental existence doesn't exist. It can't exist. We're freedom in the now. There's no existence. There's no mental existence. The mind is always free in the now. It never has existence. The mind never is existent. Okay, and so we just had this, we tried a little trick on ourselves to think we're mentally existent. We're not mentally existent. We just simply are. Everything is. Everything is. All is now. All value everywhere, always. All value everywhere, always. So the wind has calmed down, and now here comes the, that was the front before the rain. That's how it happens. And we should start getting some rain coming in now. There's a blustery front coming in, roared in there. Now my brakes were bad, so I didn't drive. I had to drive another vehicle today, because I said the warning light came on a couple days ago. I said I could tell this, the brakes are really shot, and it was too dangerous. That I said I'm not going to drive anymore, so I'm going to get the brakes fixed. I have to. New brakes, but when the brakes are low, don't drive. Don't drive. So we're hitting low ebb in the world right now. Don't interact with the world. Don't get on social media. It's not worth it. Don't read the news. I've been telling you, don't get the habits of no television, no news. Blackout, you know, boycott the world is something I've been saying for years. Boycott it. And that's what I'm doing, because I don't want to see the embarrassment that everyone's bringing upon themselves. You know, it's just, no way, no way. Maybe Jesus can handle it, but I can't. Okay, let him handle it then. Let him view the world. If the world needs to be viewed by someone, let him do it. But for the rest of us, I advise not to pay any more attention to this world. Low bottom of the barrel stuff is going on, totally. And we've been trending that way for a long time. We don't need to single anyone out in particular, right? It's been an overall collective effort to, you know, try to reach the bottom. How low can we go? How absurd can we get? How off track can our attention be, really, right? The attention, play of attention of this world is just horrendous, embarrassingly horrendous. So why, again, pay any more attention to it? But why put your attention on that? Let's put our attention on the best that we can be, okay? And just focus on that. You know, how really dialed in can we be? And so let's put our attention on another world, actually. Yeah. You know, if we put our attention in the right way, what kind of world could we actually have? Let's do it right now. You know, let's see, the death-free realm, in other words. If we give up trying to fixate the mind, what kind of experiencing would we have? If we realize that we're not mentally existent, how would our experiencing be? And we could even simulate as if it were some sort of realm, okay? But what would that realm be if we were aware, awake to truth? And put our attention on that, because ultimately everyone's going to be to get there. So why should we pay attention when they're down and out like they are now? Why not emphasize what they're going to be like once they get back on their feet? I'd rather focus on that. Also, there's a lot. May has been emphasized to me from many angles that there's some shift is going to take place in May. And I've said this summer is very problematical. Okay. So we're doing our three months before the summer, our spring months, March to April 21st to May 21st to June 21st. That's springtime, and then the summer to July 21st, August 21st, and then September 21st. Those are the 3 months of summer, and so we really by May need to really be able to just turn our attention off of this world and onto some better world, some better situation, something that's just really divine. And hold that as love to everyone here, saying, this is your destiny. Because I could lose sight of that by looking at this world. I might lose sight of it and say, wow, you guys are so messed up. What a horrible destiny you're going to have. So it's better to not pay attention to what's going on in the world and put your attention on what you what their destiny ultimately is going to be, and just keep that in mind for everyone that way. But the way people are acting right now, it's too difficult. It's too difficult for just about anyone here. I think it's asking too much of us. It's just beyond, pathetic. And I don't even have a word for I don't even have a word for it. We can really it's enough's enough. I've had enough. So by May, we need to have our be able to have our attention on something divine, to that divine destiny that we'll all reach this at some point for sure, and just be on to that, and then be able to get through the summer in that way, and then by after the 21st of September, then who knows what's going to happen? Actually, that's the sign in the sky of the what was it this the sixth vial or something of tribulation, the sixth phase. Troubles could really come hard and heavy after that point. It's possible. It's possible, isn't it? I mean, we know right now it's volatile time. It's all been set up that way. It's a big mess has been made of everything, and it may not get better. So, no need to look at the mess that we're in. Let's look at our destiny of how there's like no mess at all. Everything is so flawlessly wonderful. Focus on that. Focus on that. So that's what I'm part of, and that's incentivizing everyone. It's not like, hey, I need to pay attention to how ridiculous, you are, but hey, pay attention to me, how sublime I am. It's an incentive. This is your destiny. This is your real destiny, not what you're doing now. That's not your destiny. You'll leave that behind as if it never happened, and you won't have any regrets ultimately. One insight will settle it all regrets, and you realize nothing really ever happened. We were just trying to fixate the mind in any which way we could try to do it, and we were just being very creative about that, to say the least. And we'll have a good laugh about it at some point. So how are we doing? Yeah, well, I'm hanging in here, but it's pretty chilly. I know I have a wrap here, don't I? Yeah, maybe that might help a little bit. So the dream was along those lines, heading off in a different direction. That's what literally happened, and getting out of the mainstream, abandoning the world, so to speak, heading off in a better direction, and everything was very smooth and level, and it was like we were, I was, oh man, I don't know how much this is going to help, but wow. So going down through this forest on a mountain bike, really steep, really gnarly trail. And it was dangerous and scary, and it was just so steep. You couldn't stop, hardly stop. And so finally, I just put this huge effort on. I was able to stop the bike. And that's when the miracle happened. And what ultimately happened was I then began biking along. I'm not going to give all the particulars, but I was biking along. Instead of going downhill, it was just going side hill, along the side of the hill. And there was this beautiful level path, and we went to there's a bunch of bikers with me, this group, and we went somewhere else that was very pleasant and very nice, and we just stopped going downhill entirely. We just stopped, so I was able to put the brakes on in order to do this. And that was put the brakes on Facebook last night. Just all at once, I just suddenly realized, it's do or die. I'm not going to do it piecemeal. Either I stay and go all in on Facebook, or I leave. And I decided I'm going to leave. And so just I said, that's it. I'm leaving Facebook, and boom, just click, 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 and I was out of there. So that's called slamming on the brakes. And the mountainside was getting so steep. I felt, if I don't put the brakes on now, it's going to be so steep you can't even. The brakes won't work. You won't be able to stop. So I was like stopping, just in time before the landscape became so steep. They're just everybody will be able to stop, and they'll just go careening down the mountainside and crash. It's just too much. So it's do or die. Better stop now, or it's going to be too late. So I was able to stop, and that's my destiny. wasn't easy, but it wasn't that difficult. I just, you know, God, the Holy Spirit just showed me enough where I said, okay, I don't need this. I don't want to, you know, enough's enough. And that's like, you know, decisions. I've made many decisions in my life where I've just gone cold turkey, and that was it. That was it. I said, that's enough of this. Many, many, many times. Radical changes in my life. You realize, right? You just realize, okay, well, this is it. And you walk away from it. You walk away from all your friends. You walk away from this. You just turn the chapter. Turn the page, and you're in a different chapter. And I just go into that chapter, and you know, the past is gone. It's I don't think about it. You know, focus on the new chapter. That's what we need to do. Focus on the new chapter. So, something is going to happen with me. That's for sure. I'm not going to go downhill. That's for sure. So, I'm going to be in a beautiful, level kind of state of mind. Very level-headed, you might say. Very level. And not fearful and relaxed and calm. And that's what's going to happen. Which is great. And I'm prepared. I'm prepared to not pay any more attention to this world. I've been preparing for a long time, my whole life. And I just don't care. The world's just, as the world's expressed to me, it says it loves to kill. Well, it that's just, it's a puppet. That was just words. We're the ones who are having this world act out this fantasy of killing. There isn't any world, really. That's just our own, just reflection of our own desire. We love to kill because we love to believe that we can fixate the mind. And therefore, the hallucinating the absence of God, we believe that that can become the new reality. The absence of God can become the new reality through killing. And as Jesus says, ultimately, all death is suicide, really. That's true. And beyond that, it's actually pretend suicide. It's not real. So I've had enough of this human zoo. You know, I talked to someone else today about, what was it? Yeah, I talked to a bunch of people today. Who did I talk with? I don't even know who it was, but, Oh, I remember who it was, yeah. Wow, met a lot of people today. Haight Ashbury, Summer of Love, 67. We were talking about that, and I told him I was there, and he was aware. He saw a documentary on it, and he said, you know what? The worst thing of it all was that the people who lived in Haight Ashbury district, they didn't like it at all. It was an invasion. They got invaded. They got invaded by all the flotsam and jetsam and avant-garde madness, call it whatever you want, and the drugs and the decadence and everything. That they were just, they had a beautiful, quiet neighborhood in San Francisco, and it got turned into the hippie mecca of the world, and it was became very degenerate and dangerous, and it was horrible, really, ultimately. And they weren't able to stop it, and their whole neighborhood was just ruined. I hadn't thought of it quite like that, but he said that's what he said the worst thing about it was that. Well, hasn't this world, isn't this like a nice little, was a nice kind of neighborhood, and this world has gotten invaded by these really embarrassing mind acting out in a very embarrassing way in this world right now, and you know we're like citizens, we're like been dwelling in this neighborhood, and we're saying, you know what, we don't like this. Our neighborhood's been ruined. It's time, you know, it's time to go to a different place and forget this. Forget about this. This is nonsense. So a lot of people, they moved out of Haight Ashbury. They couldn't take it anymore. Very conservative people up there. Some of them, you know, I mean, it's just very, and I mean, I was there in 1967, and I walked, you know, and then I went back later on and walked the streets, and when I was a little bit older, that area, and It wasn't pretty. A lot of people there were teenage runaways. And a lot of them were prostitutes, male and female. They were strung out on drugs. They had venereal disease. They were starving. They were hustling. There's so much hustling going on and theft. And people are so strung out on drugs. It was scary. It was really scary. And we think it was such a beautiful thing, summer of love. Not really. That was a marketing thing. It was kind of frenetic and frantic, and yeah, it was sort of like anarchy, you know. And anarchy, people, you know, there's like so much is going on, is you kind of feel like all value everywhere, always sort of feeling. So in some way, you know, anarchists are trying to represent reality, is what they're trying to do, actually. And you can't do that. You can't do it. Okay, it doesn't work. And Jesus has said that we're trying to represent reality, the essence. And you cannot represent essence. It's effectively at all. It's impossible, he says. So anarchy is trying to represent, again, God. So it had this feeling like we're getting close to God. There's no question about that. But it also was futile. Okay, it didn't work. That's what they're really doing. And of course, I still have this, you know, having lived through the whole thing, it's still part of my experiencing. And so there was this kind of love for it, in that we felt like maybe we can represent God. All value everywhere, always. Where everything is just so free-flowing, you know, free love is how they called it, free love. Which basically everyone was, you know, a sexual partner, a love partner, up there in San Francisco at the time. You know, just all ages, all, you know, let's all just love one another. Not just sexual too, but emotion, you know, hugging and kissing and just embracing one another and all this kind of stuff. They felt, you know, everyone, and just see someone walk down the street and just go over and hug them, and they'll hug you back. And it was just love, 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 love everywhere. Let's just love one another. They're trying to represent all value everywhere, always, which is God, where you don't just have one partner or one place or thing. It's just, and everything, free food, free this, you just free art. You're just here. I just did a work of art. Let me just give it to you. Okay, I mean, it's like that. Or, here, I'm a musician. I'm going to just play this song and sing for you here for free. So everybody's just doing all this stuff for free to whoever. You know, they didn't have to say, okay, we're going to sell tickets to a dance here and everything. No, they're just walking along the street and just, here's a flower. Let me give it to you. Here's some food. Here's some clothing. Let me give it to you. So it was anarchy. It was social anarchy there. And it's a powerful thing, social anarchy. But it's an attempt to represent reality. And as such, it fails. And it's not the way, it's the ego. It's the ego. The ego says, we have a new creation, and we're kind of missing the old creation. So we're going to represent the old creation within the new creation. So we're representing how the old reality was within the new reality. So it's an arrogant thing to do. It is. But it's very attractive. Okay, it's very attractive to us. Not entirely, because I most of me didn't like it. Like, yuck. Just talk about now, it's like, yeah, terrible. But it's kind of trippy, you know. And it's like, wow, what's going on? Anarchy's going on. Wow, it's chaos going on. Like, huh, I never know what's going to happen next, you know. That you know, hippie chick may just come like running over to me and grab me and say, let's go make love, you know. And here's some wine, you know, and here's a bunch of drugs. And yeah, I mean, that's what was happening. You never knew what is going to happen at all. Anything at all could happen, that kind of thing. And so you're like, you're buzzed kind of like with your expectations. You don't know what to expect. So it really, they say it's freeing and liberating from all expectations. Because And the dances were like that. You never knew what people were going to be costumed like or expressing, or the dance moves they were making. So you never knew how they were going to dance, too. Before, all the dances were like foxtrot, cha-cha-cha. Everyone knew the steps. But they were just dancing completely free-form, like anarchist, chaotically. And so you never knew what anyone else was going to dance like, what they were going to say, what they were going to do, or anything. So that was very, very, very trippy and intense. And at some level, it reminded us of God. So that's where a lot of spirituality came out of that. So we have the spirituality of, but spirituality is the belief that we can represent God in this hallucinatory new creation. We're hallucinating the absence of God and believing that's a new creation. And then we believe that we can honor and include the old creation within the new creation through spirituality. That's what we're doing, trying to do. It doesn't work at all. It doesn't work at all. And we may be coming up on a new phase of anarchy in the world. There's many, many people who want to be anarchists right now. And say, the spiritual people, we can. And that's why another reason I dropped out of Facebook. It was so many spiritual people, spirituality. There's so much spirituality. That's the wrong approach. I am too wise for that. I've been through it all. I've been through it all already. So I'm not going to make the same mistake twice. That's for sure. And I saw it and I said, enough's enough. Okay, there's the same mistake. No thanks. No thanks. And, you know, it's tough for men. In anarchy, women are the leaders of it, actually. And literally, I mean, they'll sleep with anyone. Sexual anarchy, you know, that's what was going in the 60s. Yeah, it was sexual anarchy, absolutely. And, you know, for me, if you're like kind of a shy, retiring kind of male, you know, it's like, wow, what the heck's going on? You know, suddenly I'm attractive. No, you're not. They're just trying to act out anarchy. And then once that phase is over, they don't even know who you are. You're scum. You're worthless scum to them. Where's your money? You know, then after they figure out that this just didn't work so as much like why? Well, they're looking for a millionaire then. And these hippie chicks, and a lot of them, you know, try to marry, you know, stockbrokers and stuff. Whatever, lawyers. But when anarchy hits, it's you can get easily swept up in it. Really easily swept up. It's a super dangerous thing, anarchy. And again, what is anarchy? It's an attempt to represent God in this imaginary, hallucinatory new creation, by saying like, "Well, we got a new creation, and we still have some feelings for the old creation, and so just to show how much better than God we are, God won't let us have a new. God tried to stop us, but we got a new creation. Lord, no hard feelings to the old creation at all. We're going to include that old creation within the new creation, and we'll just represent it. We'll just represent what it was. That's all." Honor it that way, honoring the old creation, then the new one. And that is spirituality and anarchy. First anarchy, and then out of that spirituality comes. Where we say, okay, we honored it that way, and now we're going to try to systematize it a little better and, you know, get it more structured. Get all value everywhere, always a little more structured, you know, because that's what the new creation's about. So the new creation is improving upon the old creation by turning spirit as it is in the now into spirituality. So out of the 60s came all the spirituality. We didn't have it before then. The new age did not exist before the 60s, okay? The 60s invented the new age, actually. By and large, right? There might have been a few anomalies, but as we know it, that started in the 60s. Started, yeah, with the anarchy that happened around the world, really. Beatlemania kind of helped start it in 64, late 63 in England, 64. And that started, you know, Twist and Shout was the Beatles' final song at the London Palladium in October of 63. You know, hey, everybody, you know, and first I think... John Lennon told everybody to shut up because all the kids were screaming, and all these stayed, you know, adults, you know, very respectable adults were there, and they couldn't hear the music. They said, hey, shut up to the young kids. And then I think Paul McCartney said, well, you know, you clap your hands and stomp your feet. Clap your hands and stomp your feet, kids. And so they started doing that. And then at the end, they got into Twist and Shout. The final, you know, yeah, that's a very, very anarchic type of song. The Beatles are very much anarchic, anarchists. And wow, that wind is just insane. I heard something, bam. This is like 40 mile an hour wind that's going on here. It's not some of the strongest wind we've had all winter. Anyway, shake it up, baby, now, yeah. Twist and shout, come on, little baby, now. We'll come on and work it all out, yeah, work it on out. You know you twist, little girl. You know you twist so fine. Come on a little closer now. And so like, what is it? So I can make you mine. Why? You know, screaming, why? Scream of anarchy. Yeah, twist, come on, baby, twist and shout. So they're screaming, anarchy, screams of anarchy. Just let everybody just, let's twist and shout together. And that really, you know, was the spark that lit the fire. It became the Summer of Love in 67 in San Francisco, which was really the spark that lit the fire of spirituality that's still rampaging throughout the world. It was really anarchy brought to the highest pitch at that point. It really was. And, you know, the raves have come from all that, which is more anarchy and stuff. But the Summer of Love in San Francisco was, you know, that was just a mind blower for society, corporate society of the 50s and early 60s culture, which is a very decent, super decent culture. Very lovely people. Very common sense, decent, hardworking, caring, kind people. And, but, so for them, they were just shocked by it. It was just stunning and shocking. And the anarchists rubbed it in their faces the rest of their lives, is what they did, basically. It was really horrible to see. I mean, that's another thing that's so extremely embarrassing. I should not even pay attention to the whole thing. This world, never pay attention to this world. It's just rotten. The way that the older generation was treated by the anarchists of the younger generation was simply appalling. You know, they were like the idiots, you know, the wicked idiots that didn't know anything. And it breaks my heart to even think about it. And fortunately, it died down in some cases, but you know, it was brutal. It was really brutal. Sometimes, you know, younger generations can be very brutal to the older generations, especially when they go into anarchy mode. And we may be right at that mode coming up here, folks. Jesus told me, back off Facebook. That's it. Boom, I did it. So Jesus is in the house, big time, to say the least. Leading us away from this anarchy. We don't want to pay attention to it. Reality cannot be represented. Cannot be represented. It's impossible. And it's arrogant to try to do so. It has to be... We don't experience it. We are it, you see. Mentally existent is this existent. The idea is that we're experiencing spirit. No. We are spirit, and the delusion is that we're experiencing reality. No, we are reality. Okay, we are reality. We're not experiencing reality. We are reality. So the idea that we're experiencing reality is spirituality, which is an attempt to represent reality in an imagined new creation, which is, again, we're hallucinating the absence of God, all right, thinking that's a new creation. And then trying to stabilize that hallucination through death, through killing. And ultimately all death is suicide. So you have an elder statesman here who's been through the anarchy and so now has perspective on this and can speak to you like this. I should speak as an elder statesman if anyone will listen. Certainly there was not many on Facebook listening, willing to listen. So I'm not going to, you know, Jesus said, look, you go into a town, you evangelize. If they don't want to listen, shake the dust of the town off your sandals and head for the next place. Okay? Don't hang around those who who are hard-headed and won't take it to heart. And that's the Christian way, is you know, you if you see that they're not taking it to heart, move on. So I've moved on. What a gift that man gave me today. The gift of Christian greatness. You know, what a gift he gave me. It's priceless what he gave me. I don't know how I can possibly, you know, I can't, you know, pay him back, or I'll, you know, try. What can I do? You just take it, accept it. Just listening to him maybe was enough payback for him. Just the fact that I took it to heart and listened and really appreciate it. Maybe that was, for him, was really great too, right? And so it works both ways. There's some different Christians. Some are angry Christians, but this man is a loving Christian. Uh-oh. What is that? Somebody texting me? What in the world are they texting me about at this time? Uh-oh, don't tell me it's the baseball. It's got to be, right? Yeah. No, it's not. Okay. Okay. So I'm getting a picture from Hawaii. Someone just sent me, they're in Hawaii, and they just sent me a live, a bunch of pictures of the sunset in Hawaii. Interesting. I don't know if you can see that. My phone's so small, but it's there you go. That's the sunset in Hawaii. There's some pictures they're sending me of Hawaii. So sunrise this morning from Molokai, and sunset from Waikiki this evening. Okay. Wow, isn't that interesting that someone said suddenly, I've never had anyone text me pictures from Hawaii. Send me pictures from Hawaii. That's the first time ever. So maybe someone's telling, I mean, you talk about beautiful place. I mean, Molokai and Waikiki on the same day. Also, yeah. So, isn't that amazing what happens? God is wonderful, huh? You make a commitment and he comes through for you. F-I-R-C. How do you spell fiercely? Okay, I forget, I don't know how to spell fiercely. Can you spell that? Strongly. I'll do strongly instead. I can spell that. Okay, there you go. I get a picture of the yacht harbor at Molokai, and the sunset at the beach. The morning in Molokai, sunrise and sunset at Waikiki, and it looks absolutely gorgeous. And we're talking about how going to a better place where it's nice and relaxed and beautiful and calm. Well, Molokai kind of is a place like that, isn't it? It's just that, you know, what's going on in the rest of the world really doesn't really impact it. They don't really focus on it at all. So there you go. There's an example, kind of a perfect example of you know, the idea of going somewhere that's really beautiful and represents the best of our destiny, at least until we finally drop, you know, the idea of that we're mentally existent, and ultimately we drop that, we realize we are reality. It's not that we're experiencing reality. We are reality. It's not that subject-object, like subject. And reality is the object, and we're the subject experiencing it. No, we are reality. We are reality. We are God. All is God. All is God. All is God. Okay. All value everywhere always is always the case. Okay. There's no one experiencing that. There's just everything being that. There's just everything being that. So here we go to... I suddenly get this right here. Taping a picture from Molokai. I've never seen Molokai, never been there. and then Honolulu, Waikiki. I don't know if I've ever been to Waikiki either. I don't think I have. Even though I lived in Hawaii, we lived a little bit north of Honolulu, and I don't think we went to Waikiki very often. I can't remember. At one time, and then one time I was near Diamond Head, which was beautiful. That's a little south, kind of down from Waikiki, actually. I'd love to see Waikiki. It's a lot of people go there, right? But Molokai is a whole different story. That's like pristine Hawaii, really off the beaten track. Very few people live on the island. I just heard like 4,000 people or something. It's really very, very old, unchanged Hawaii, with the countryside. A lot of deer roaming everywhere. You know, a lot of animals and. I don't know, I'll find out how it was. Probably pretty nice. Shoot. That's scary, this wind. I don't get scared very easily, but this wind is ferocious. Whoa, it shook everything in here right there. The computer got shaken there. I'm holding on to it right now. Good Lord, protect us here. Maybe this is, you know, making this taping, it telling you about what's to come, anarchy to come. This feels very anarchic, if that's a word, right now. The weather out here, it feels like anarchy. I mean, it's blowing in every different direction. It's there's no particular direction out there. It's just going every which way. I've got a bunch of trees around here. I don't want, you know, stand tall trees. I mean, come on. This is... ferocious. So, is there life after Facebook? So far, I take it a day at a time. So, today there was life. Life more abundant, actually, than on Facebook. I had a better experiencing today than I would have had on Facebook. Better experiencing, believe it or not. More profound, more hopeful. Facebook is an extreme addiction, actually. But it's underwhelming. It's kind of, you get underwhelmed by it. You know, it's weird. There's so much volume going on, but the quantity is awesome, but the quality is very underwhelming, actually, compared to like the experience I had today. Like the dream I had last night was just so extraordinary. It was big time all the way, and then experiencing today's big time all the way. So, you know, there's at least one day after Facebook. Let's see if there's 2 days after Facebook. I say, God, I put my fate, destiny in your hands, God, and you know, you just, you know, don't bore me to death. I mean, I don't know what to do with my time. I don't go out, so, you know, I just sit around the computer. What's there to do? I can't even use a computer anymore, really. I don't know what to do with my life. I don't know what's going to happen. I really don't. Facebook's a way to kill a lot of time, right, in the evening, right? I don't watch television, and I don't read books or do anything like that. I'm tired of all that stuff. At least there's beautiful photos and quotes and things, and you think it's like killing time by doing this. So, you know, it's got to be, God has to do something God will show me what the next chapter of my life is going to be like, for sure. I was told that today. Jesus will point out to you what he wants you to do, for sure. Okay, so let's see if there's day two after Facebook. Day one was a success, huge success, and continuing on. Okay, they still have an hour or two left in the day, and you never know what can happen in that hour. All right, full stop in the wow practice all the way. It's absolutely fabulous what's going on right here, right now. Wow.